Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cult Classic by Stephen Blackmoore. Narrated by Rudy, Sanda. Chapter 1. The air is filled with the screaming buzz of high-powered engines as F1 race cars zip by below. Long Beach Grand Prix. Every year, they shut down some streets near the marina and turn Shoreline Drive into a racetrack. Stands are filled with fans under a blazing sun. Some places in April are still under snow, but out here in Southern California, we barely know what rain looks like. I've never really gotten the appeal of car racing. It's like baseball. When it comes down to it, it's all just a bunch of guys running around in a circle. Although racing at least has the added benefit of one of them occasionally flipping over and exploding. If that happened in baseball, I would watch the shit out of that. "Which room?" I say. Danny hands me his binoculars. We're standing on the roof of the Long Beach Performing Arts Center, facing the Hyatt Regency Hotel. 12 up, 8 in from the left," he says. It takes me a second to find it and focus in. "Yeah, that's her," I say. Nicole Hawthorne. A trim black woman who used to do the whole sex kitten routine to get what she wanted. It's been almost 30 years since we met, and she could still pull it off. She's also one of the more dangerous mages I've met. Not for her specific magic, though believe me, she's no slouch, but because of her patron, a talking head named Jimmy Freeberg. And when I say talking head, I don't mean some guy behind a desk on cable news. I mean a literal talking head. Jimmy's an oracle, a terrifyingly powerful artifact with the ability to tell the future by dint of being able to manipulate the future. Jimmy sees patterns, consequences. It then finds the one or two events that would make things work out differently and changes them. They're not usually big changes. They don't have to be. They're a zig instead of a zag. A single domino tipping the wrong direction. "Actually, it isn't her," Danny says. Danny's second-generation Korean-American. Short, maybe 5'2". Built like a fire plug, arms like fucking tree trunks. He hands me a different set of binoculars. They're dark blue with a crystal embedded into a socket on the top. I look through the new binoculars at the window, and instead of Nicole, I see silhouettes of 5 figures. 3 are definitely men. Not sure about the other 2. They're all slightly different colors. "These aren't thermal," I say. "Auras," he says. "Handy for punching through illusions." I pick the regular binoculars back up and look again.
"It's a damn good illusion."
"Oh, yeah. Unless you're watching for a long time. All she's done for the last 2 hours is pace in front of that window."
"I assume that's bait," I say.
Of course it's bait. And, of course, it's a trap.
"You would assume correctly. Your fans are getting cleverer. Bounty's up to a couple million bucks."
"Seriously? I'm barely worth $1.50. This mean you're upping your rates?"
"Excuse me," he says. "I'm a professional. I won't sell you out for anything less than 6.
"Always nice to know what a man's price is."
I've been looking for Nicole for the last 3 months. She's also been looking for me. Only where I've got just me and some occasional help from Danny here, she's been hiring teams of mercenaries. This is the 6th time we've done this particular dance. From what I can tell, she doesn't want to kill me, just capture me. Only problem is that she's been sending normals, people with no magic, to take me on. They don't usually last very long.
"This changes things," I say.
"Damn right it does," Danny says. "That is one fucking good illusion."
"At least one of them's a mage," I say. "Where did you hear about this?"
"You're gonna laugh," he says. "Leather Charlie."
"Charlie's still alive?"
"Yeah. Fuck knows how. He was dropping your lady friend's name like it was hot coals."
Danny and I go back to before I was run out of L.A. We weren't terribly close, but we ran in similar circles. Both of us fought at a place called Quick Change Alice's Bar and Brawl, an underground mage fighting ring. Think MMA with fireballs. We shared another thing in common at the time. We both did a lot of cocaine. Charlie was our dealer. Danny and I ran into each other again years later in Miami. He was doing security. He needed someone who could deal with some local ghosts. We worked a couple of jobs together over the years.
She's not at this one either, I say.
Nicole wasn't at any of the previous attempts to take me on.
Why would she need to be? All she has to do is throw money around and let her mercs do the rest. I'm thinking their plan is that they figure I'll see this, come to the room expecting to find Nicole alone, and instead find myself face to face with five assassins.
Another reason I think she isn't here is Jimmy. Since Jimmy can see potential futures, it's real hard to sneak up on the damn thing. If I find Nicole, then chances are it wants me to find her. That's the trap I'm really worried about. There are only two people Jimmy can't see, the people who created it. It doesn't perceive things the way it did when it was human. Instead of sight, it perceives chances and possibilities. One of those people is Nicole. It can see her to an extent. She's hazy, like static. That's because she's been its keeper for the last, going on, 30 years. Proximity has made her easier to see. She's as much a victim of the situation as anyone its influence affects. As to the other person who made it, that would be me.
What it looks like, Danny says. It's a stupid plan, major no. You'd be walking into a kill box or going through the window and they'd be waiting for you.
Nicole's the bait, I say.
They're the trap.
You'd be stupid to go in.
Yep, I say.
You're going in anyway?
Yep. Can you hit them from here?
I would be vaguely insulted if I didn't want to show you my new toys, he says. I've got the same aura rig on my AR-15. Got it chambered for 338. I can take them down before they know what hit them.
Okay. I'm gonna head over there. I'll let you know when I'm at the door. Leave one of them alive, and try not to pop too many heads. Might need to talk to a dead one.
I ever tell you necromancers are fucking creepy?
Few thousand times. You good?
Yeah. I'll be set up by the time you get over there.
The hotel's soundproofing is impressive. I can barely hear the cars outside. The room's easy enough to find. 12th floor, 8 in from the left. The hallway's empty. From what Danny could see, the rooms to either side are empty, and the rest have two or three people in each doing pretty much nothing. If we do this right, there shouldn't be much noise to get their attention. I saw Nicole and Jimmy last in Las Vegas. Jimmy had manipulated me into a position where if I wanted to save the soul of another mage, one who I care very much about, Gabriela Cortez, I needed to break it out of a Las Vegas casino vault. That thing about me being one of the people Jimmy can't see? Turns out that since it can't see me, it couldn't tell the guy who had it that I was coming. I was camouflage. At least, that's all I thought I was. The question was, how was it captured in the first place? Easy. It wanted to be. There was this rock, an opal, one of a set, most of which are at the bottom of the ocean, last I'd heard. Stupidly powerful artifacts, though nobody seems to really know what they do. Powerful enough that Jimmy can't see them either. Seems they're naturally resistant to its powers. I do know what one of them does. It can sort of raise the dead, though fucked if I know how. There's a guy, Zombie Joe. Hates it when I call him that. Gabriella has him working for her. He was murdered and brought back using one of them. Now he's got it sitting in his chest so he doesn't go all George Romero and start eating people. I hear it's pretty messy. So, Jimmy couldn't see the Vegas opal, but it knew who had it. Magic? No. Just shipping records and a minion who could sort through them.
We break Jimmy out. Everything's great. I get what I need. Jimmy gets out with the opal. Happily ever after for everybody. And only 3 casinos burned down. And then I find out that Nicole went around later to all the people who had helped us get Jimmy out and murdered them. And not just them, everybody around them. It was brutal and cruel, and I don't know why she did it. Some of them were her friends. At least, they thought they were her friends. I guess I'm lucky that way. Nicole and I were never friends. It'll make killing her a lot easier on the conscience.
How many is this now?
Danny says. I've got an earpiece hooked to a 2-way radio in my pocket.
5,
I say. No. 6? I've lost count. The first 2 traps were obvious. A couple of normals, people without magic, lying in wait for me. Once near my place in Venice Beach, and once in downtown L.A. They weren't very smart. Now, they're very dead. After that, they got smarter. This is the first time they've used something as sophisticated as an illusion, though.
2 of you must be tight for her to go to all this trouble.
Oh, yeah. Thick as thieves.
I just wish I knew why she was going to all this trouble. The thing that worries me is that this is a setup for a setup. That's the thing with Jimmy. It manipulates things in small enough ways that you might not know it's happened until it's too late.
Once I took care of business in Vegas, I was too eager to leave. It was when I was too far outside the city to do anything about it that Nicole went on her murder spree. I won't make that same mistake.
This trap might just be maneuvering pieces before the real one gets sprung.
I can only think that this is because of that opal.
Because I kinda stole it. Unlike the opal in Zombie Joe, the Vegas opal seems to be more of a battery. At least, that's what Jimmy's using it for. Jimmy had a device built that allows it to project its powers a couple of weeks into the past. Normally, if it wants a thing to happen today, it would have to have set it in motion yesterday or earlier. The device lets it do exactly that. It's made Jimmy a lot more powerful and a lot more frightening. I palmed the opal out of it. The device is useless without it. I've seen the kind of effect it can have. Fuck if I was gonna let Jimmy have it. I press myself against the wall next to the hotel room door. I can't feel any spells being cast. An illusion like the one at the window isn't going to be coming from someone casting it. They'd have to be concentrating to keep it up.
4 hours plus is a bit much even for a good mage. Probably a projection artifact. You can buy them pretty cheap if you have the right connections, but this looks like more of a specialty item, meaning these guys are well-funded.
Mages can sense other mages when we cast spells or draw power from the local well of magic that surrounds everything.
Artifacts are a different matter.
Sometimes we can feel them when they do their thing, but more often than not, their magic doesn't register.
I've got a straight razor that can cut through bone like it's jello, for example, and it doesn't feel like anything other than a straight razor, even when I make it appear in my hand out of thin air. Or it makes itself appear. It has something of a mind of its own, and appears sometimes before I realize I need it. Nobody's casting, I say.
That's actually a little troubling.
No reason I should expect anyone to have a spell running, but I'd at least expect to feel somebody tapping the local well of power, if only a little bit at a time. Do it a little bit at a time, it can be hard to notice. But if you know what you're looking for, it's easy to spot. I've done it myself plenty of times.
But there's nothing.
I got a shot, Danny says.
Fuck. Is this another trick?
Some other bullshit to get me to lower my guard? Yeah. We're not playing that game. Take it, I say.
Showtime!
I hear the window shatter as 4 bullets punch through and find their marks. Hysterical screaming from the lone survivor, who yanks the door open and runs out into the hallway. He barely clears the threshold before I'm on him, arm against his throat, shoving him back inside the room.
I
kick the door closed with my foot. He trips, falls, and I drop onto him, knees in his guts and a gun in his face.
"Hi," I say.
"I understand you're trying to kill me."
I knocked the wind out of him, so he's not saying anything for a minute.
"But if this is a hardened killer, I'm Santa Claus."
He's a stereotypical Huntington Beach surfer dude. White guy, perfectly tanned skin, blonde hair with frosted tips, board shorts he's currently pissing in. I look around the suite.
The other four are pretty much the same. Two women, two men. They all look like extras from Point Break.
A table in the middle of the room holds a mini keg and a stack of red Solo cups.
I'm beginning to get a very bad feeling about this.
"Please don't kill me. Please don't kill me."
His voice is barely a wheeze.
"What are you doing here?"
"We got the room comped. There was some lady checking out early, so we got an upgrade. And we got a keg, and Luke was gonna ask Melody to marry him this weekend, and oh my God, you killed them. You killed them both, what the hell?"
I dig the gun into his forehead. "Shut it. Who's the woman who checked out?"
"I don't know. Some lady."
Fuck. Fuck, fuck, fuck.
This wasn't the ambush. It was the bait.
"We've been played," I say into the radio. "These are a bunch of surfer kids. You seeing any movement?"
"No, I... Wait. Yeah. Three rooms away on either side, just headed out the door. I'd say 10 total. I can't get a shot yet."
Damn it. We should have just walked away from this one. The people we saw in other rooms scattered around the floor were the ones waiting for me.
They weren't moving around like mercs waiting for their target, so, of course, it didn't occur to either of us that that was exactly what they were. "I'm thinking you're about to have some visitors of your own," I say. "Cover your ass. I got this."
"Good point," he says. "If I can, I'll give you some support. In the meantime, don't get killed. You owe me money."
I get up from the floor and pull Surfer Boy up with me. "You and your friends were set up. It's about to get very loud in here. Go into the bathroom, close the door, get in the tub. Do not come out until you hear nothing for at least 10 minutes.
He's in shock, but he's not stupid. He bolts for the bathroom. Better to have him out of the way,
because he's really not going to be okay with this next bit.
I throw out a spell that's got enough juice behind it that if there are any mages in this building who didn't know I was here, they sure as hell do now.
"All right,"
I say.
"Up and at 'em."
The four corpses stand up.
Danny did a good job.
Clean kills right through the heart.
They were dead before they hit the floor. "You two, stand over by the door. Stay out of sight. Grab the fourth and fifth people who come through after they've passed you. You two, get on either side of the entryway. You go after anybody who makes it past you."
They hurry to their respective spots and wait. "What the fuck did you just do?" Danny says. "That was a shit ton of power, and four people just appeared in the room. They have really fucked up auras."
"You really want to know?"
"This is necromancer shit, isn't it?"
"It is. So, if you'll excuse me."
I used to only be able to animate a person like a puppet. But over the last few years, I've picked up a thing or two. You'd think the fact that I was dead at the time might have gotten in the way of my learning anything, but it was kind of a job requirement. This time is easier than the last time, and provided I survive this, I suspect the next time will be even easier. Now, I can raise a handful of corpses, give them vague orders, and they'll handle themselves. Not well, but they'll do it. I'm honestly not sure if that's good or bad.
I can hear running footsteps in the hall.
If these guys are professionals, and I don't see any reason they wouldn't be, they're going to throw a flashbang in first to disorient me and... yeah, that's so not happening.
I cast a spell that creates a bubble of silence in front of the door, extending into the rest of the room. It doesn't have to last long.
pull a couch away from under the window and get behind it. I'm still not sensing any spells. The door explodes silently in as they hit it with a battering ram. In comes the flashbang. I turn my head away and duck, covering and closing my eyes. Even still, I can make out the intense burst of light through my eyelids. As soon as it goes dark, I'm up, and I pop a couple rounds into the first guy through the door.
Problem is, he's carrying a ballistic shield.
Tall shield to cover the entire body with only a slit in the front to look through. The first shot misses completely. The next two ricochet off the shield. But the fourth one goes through the slit and into his faceplate. I feel him die as he goes down. One of the more annoying aspects of being a necromancer. The guy behind him almost trips over him. Within that bubble of silence, he didn't hear my gunshots. He and the one after him stumble into the room and get a very rude surprise as two undead surfer boys descend on them. Over by the door, the next two are coming in, only to get grabbed and yanked off their feet by my other corpses. It's a surreal scene. Like watching a silent 1920s zombie film. I almost expect a placard to appear that says, "Rawrgh!" in flowing script. Five down, five to go. Or not. I put down one as they come in, and the next two's heads explode when Danny hits them through the window. I will my mini-zombie horde out the door to get the last two in the hall. My silence spell doesn't extend to the hallway, so I can only imagine the kind of racket they're making. I feel the final two die under the teeth and hands of the recently dead. When I step out into the hall, the sound comes back, and I can hear wet, tearing noises as the zombies rip into the corpses. I don't know why they do that. It's not like they need to eat. Is it me? Do I have decades of zombie movies subconsciously shaping the spell? I'll have to look into that. I kill the spell, and all four zombies drop to the floor. I bend down to one of the more intact mercenary corpses, pull his gun, and check the magazine. Rubber bullets. He's got a taser on his belt and a bunch of nylon zip-tie restraints. I roll him over, and my hand brushes against them, and I can feel the magic coming off them. Motherfucker. These are mage shackles. You can't just slap handcuffs on a mage. They'll turn them to smoke, dissolve them, shatter them, whatever. So, some asshole during the Inquisition came up with these fun little toys. They suppress a mage's ability to cast. I've seen them done as handcuffs, bracelets, collars, a remarkable amount of bondage gear, on and on. Never seen them as zip ties before. Makes sense. Go after a mage, you want to be prepared. But why do they have so many? Could be useful. I reach to pull them off his belt and get a better idea. I pull two "Hi, my name is" stickers from a spool in my messenger bag, write "You can't see me" on them, slap one onto the front of my jacket, the other onto the corpse, and shove a burst of magic into them. This whole place is going to get really crowded really fast, and I don't want anyone to get in my way. All right, I say. Let's go. The corpse pulls itself to its feet, staggers a bit, and then steadies itself. Follow my lead, don't touch anybody, and try not to leak too much if you can. You and me, we're gonna go take a drive and have a chat.
Hey!
Danny's voice, but tinny and distant. The earpiece has fallen out and it's hanging by its spiral cord. I get it reseated. Yeah, I say.
Why weren't you answering?
Silence spell. You all right?
Yeah, Danny says. They sent a couple up here all right. Makes sense. This is the only spot to get a clear enough view of the room. But we can compare notes later. Long Beach PD just rolled up with a dozen squad cars and a SWAT van.
Good to know, I say. On my way out.
Hey, did I just murder four kids?
No, I say. Nicole did. Chapter 2. I met Nicole right before I left Vegas almost 30 years ago.
I went out there when I had to leave L.A. to keep a crime boss from murdering what was left of my family and friends. Not long after arriving, I hooked up with a bunch of other mages robbing private vaults, museums, the occasional bank. We were children. A bunch of amoral reprobates and psychopaths. I left when the psychopath bit became a little too apparent in a couple of them. I'm not entirely sure why I did. I think I still had something akin to ethics at the time. But some crack in me was letting all that leak out, and I felt like I was losing myself. So I left. Shouldn't have bothered. Lost myself anyway. That's when I connected with Jimmy. Decent guy. Not too bright. Did a lot of meth. But he needed a roommate and left me alone. Except for all the times I bailed him out of jail. I wonder sometimes why I did. I told myself it was because he was useful to me, so I couldn't have him locked up someplace. But that was bullshit. The thing about Jimmy is that he was a mage who didn't know he was a mage. Didn't even know magic existed. He had one trick, and he didn't even know he was doing it. Every mage has a knack, that one type of magic they're stupidly good at. Some never figure out what theirs is, but most of us still have one. Some people get healing, divination, flight, whatever. Me? I got necromancy. Jimmy got a weird and largely useless form of invisibility. Useless for him, anyway. He was this sort of black hole to scrying. Magical senses just slid right off him. He didn't ping anyone's magical radar unless they were looking the right way. And the effect extended to the places he spent a lot of time at. His apartment, a couple strip clubs, the North Las Vegas jail. Which meant it was great for hiding me. It's funny how much time and effort we spend on justifying all our choices to ourselves. Because I wanna never seems to be good enough. Truth is, I felt sorry for the guy. Not exactly a part of who I thought I was. So I lied and pretended that I didn't care and went and bailed him out anyway. And then he got caught cheating at a casino. Like I said, he wasn't very smart. One, don't cheat at a casino. They'll catch you. Two, don't cheat at a casino run by a mage. They'll make your life miserable. The mage running the place, one Sebastian McCord, noticed the Jimmy-shaped hole in his awareness of his casino floor and went to investigate. He found out Jimmy knew me, and that's when the fun really started.
"Why is there a dead SWAT officer in my morgue?" Kyle says.
Kyle is a medical examiner for the county of Los Angeles. He also moonlights as a doctor and coroner for some of LA's supernaturals here, here being a homeless shelter in downtown LA that caters to humans and supernaturals both. Although, the two types of clientele are kept very, very separate. One, it's not your morgue, it's Gabriella's. Two, despite all the black BDUs and tactical gear, he's not a SWAT officer. And three, where the hell else would I take him? He's dead.
"I recall you just leaving bodies by the side of the road," he says.
"Give a hoot. Don't pollute."
"Uh-huh. How'd he die?"
"Bullet through the heart."
Amazingly, the bullet didn't hit anything else. But that's magic for ya. Danny's one of the better combat mages out there. Kyle is a fairly unassuming guy. Bald, with little wisps of white hair around the edges of his scalp. He has a weird gait. Arms are just a touch too long. Otherwise, he looks completely normal. Unless he's eating. Kyle's a ghoul. Ghouls eat carrion, preferably human. For the most part, they pass as human just fine, more or less. Until they eat, at which point their jaws unhinge, their throats puff out, and you get a good look at the rows of sharp teeth going all the way down their throat like a snapping turtle's. Sometimes they eat things a little more lively than carrion.
"Really? Why's he here?" Kyle says.
"I was hoping I could put him on ice for a bit in case I need to ask him more questions."
"Ask him more? Can I use a drawer?"
He was sitting in the car with me up from Long Beach for 2.5 hours with the AC blasting. I've slowed the degeneration down, but he's starting to get ripe.
Fine. Drawer 12.
Awesome. You heard the man. Drawer 12.
The body levers up from the waist and slides off the autopsy table. He walks past Kyle, opens the drawer, and clambers inside, pulling the drawer closed behind him. To his credit, Kyle doesn't even flinch.
What the actual fuck was that? Kyle says.
Figured neither one of us needed a strained back hauling him into the drawer, I say. He's got legs. He can do it himself.
I liked you better when you were dead, he says. You know, I had you opened up on a table down in Mission.
I'd heard my body had been cremated with no fanfare, so I'm a little surprised it went down to the morgue on Mission Road.
You take any choice bits home to eat, I say.
Oh, hell yeah, Kyle says. Your kidneys were great.
Glad I was good for something.
Kyle's got a sweet gig at the coroner's office. He has access to some choice cuts of fresh meat. All the guts and the brain from a body get tossed into a viscera bag during the autopsy and are supposed to be cremated. Instead, a lot of it goes into Kyle's freezer. It's a position some ghouls would kill for, and from what I understand, have. Things have calmed down, but apparently there were some really messy fights among the ghoul population in the 60s, each trying to knock out the competition. But then the 80s happened, the murder rate skyrocketed, and there was plenty of fresh meat to go around.
You need me to do anything to your corpse?
You already did.
I mean the one in drawer 12.
Right. No, I think he's good.
We were stuck on the 405 with nothing else to do, so I made the best of the time and had a chat.
I had to use a little magic to slow down his body from doing what bodies do. Trust me, you don't want that kind of mess when you're crawling past LAX.
His name was Philip. A Marine, he made it to E7, gunnery sergeant, before cashing out and going the military contractor route. Did some official stuff in Iraq, some off-the-books jobs in Libya, Sudan, Somalia. Then, about a year ago, hooked up with a group who only did stateside jobs. That's where he ran into mages for the first time. He adjusted pretty quickly. Did a few jobs with magical backup. Strangely, the one in Long Beach didn't have anything with magic beyond the illusion of Nicole and equipping the team with mage restraints. Philip didn't know why.
Didn't know a lot of stuff. No idea who hired them, why, what was supposed to happen once they got me into a van. Wish I'd known which one of them was the driver. But he did know who his boss was. Some guy named Miles Kendrick, I say. I've called Danny as I leave the morgue.
Know him?
Ugh. Yeah. Kind of a prick. I can get hold of him. Getting any client info out of him is going to be tough. Or expensive.
Tell him if he doesn't give his client up, I'll fill his house with undead cockroaches.
You do know that going straight to intimidation is not the best opening move for this sort of thing, right?
It's always worked for me, I say.
Of course it has. All right. I'll give you a call when I know more. Don't get tased and tossed in a van. I'd hate to have to come rescue you.
You're adorable, I say, and hang up.
A few minutes later, my phone rings, and I think Danny can't have come up with anything that quickly. But it's Gabriella, and my day suddenly feels better. Things have changed between us lately, though I'm honestly not sure how much. We're dating, I guess. She's also dating another mage, Amanda Werther. It does feel a little weird sometimes, but good weird.
Usually, I date somebody, they eventually try to kill me. We got that out of the way when we first met.
Hey, Gabriella says. It's good to hear her voice. Funny.
I'm still not sure how I feel about us, but I guess that's a positive sign?
Hey, I say back.
You don't sound good. What happened?
You got all that from one word?
I know you better than you think I do, she says. What happened?
stepped into another one of Nicole's little funhouse traps. Accidentally murdered 4 kids. They were bait. There's a long pause as she processes that.
Is this Long Beach? She says.
Already made the news, huh?
14 dead, suspect in custody, she says.
Christ. Like, the kid's got enough on his plate. Now some asshole detective's gonna try to pin this on him. That won't stick, I say. They'll figure out all the shots came from a sniper rifle or a 40 caliber, and they won't find either one there. Then they'll have to explain how 4 dead teenagers ate a bunch of armored mercenaries. I give her the highlights.
Are you okay?
No, I say. Danny's probably worse, though. He's the one who took the shots. I stink of gunpowder, but a change of clothes and a shower and I should be fine. I dropped off my new mercenary friend in the shelter morgue with Kyle. I forgot a bag here with some clothes, so I figured I'd stop instead of driving all the way back down to Venice.
Gabriella is not the typical mage for L.A., or anywhere, for that matter. She owns and operates this Skid Row homeless shelter. She has to do a lot of business with the city, goes to council meetings, actively runs protests in support of the homeless, stuff like that. She's got a recognizable face to some of the normals, so she tries to keep a lid on the magic in the area lest someone start putting pieces together. She used to own an old SRO, single-room occupancy, hotel in downtown Los Angeles that she used for the same thing. Pretty typical for an SRO. Old, run down, barely holding together. Except most of the residents weren't human. Vampires, Aswang, ghouls. She let all sorts in. No judgment. Just don't kill anybody that leads the cops to her door. It worked out pretty well for her, except that to fund all that, she made herself a nice little criminal empire in downtown Los Angeles. Knockoff Chanel handbags and fake Rolexes down in Santee Alley, mostly. Also, robbing the occasional dealer and pimp who strayed a little too close to her territory. She made sure everybody who needed them had clean needles, a place to get a shower, food to eat. Basically, taking care of her little corner of the neighborhood. It didn't last.
Forgot, she says.
I can hear her smiling, which you'd think isn't a thing, but, well, I can. Okay, kind of forgot.
And wasn't home on the way?
Yes, you caught me. I have an ulterior motive of wanting to see you. And dropping a corpse off in your morgue because he was starting to smell up around Torrance, but mostly just to see you.
A nefarious plot? Whatever shall I do?
I can think of a few things.
Do you want to leave a toothbrush? She says. I hear that's the next step in a relationship.
You want to leave one at my place?
I kinda already did, she says.
Tells you how observant I am.
Sadly, I am not going to be back for a while, I think, she says. Do you have anything else going on today besides almost getting tased by mercenaries?
Thought I'd live dangerously and go hit Okie Dog.
I can't believe you actually eat that stuff.
Come on. A chili hot dog pastrami burrito? That's like the turducken of shitty L.A. fast food.
I admire that you're so committed to gastric distress that you'll cross La Brea for it, she says. But if you're gonna drive all that way, I have a better idea. Got a mystery needs solving. Wanna come play Scooby-Doo?
Is this a sex thing, I say. Because if it's a sex thing, I am totally on board.
Maybe after, she says. I can dress up as Velma and you can look for clues.
Tease. Where do I meet you?
Simi Valley.
You're fucking kidding me.
Simi Valley is just outside L.A. County at the base of the Simi Hills.
Not much around it but scrub brush, so it burns on the regular. In terms of miles, it's not that far. In terms of time, it might as well be the fucking moon.
Ja, I know, she says. Take the 118, get off at Erringer and take a left. There's a Motel 6. And meet you in the parking lot.
Gonna be a bit. I need to get cleaned up. Unless you want me to show up smelling like a crime scene.
Now is the tease.
You want to walk me through this, I say? You had a guy up here to check this place and he never came back out?
We're standing in front of a house nestled off to the side of a fire road in the Seamy Hills.
We had to walk through a barely visible path through the scrub to get to it. There isn't so much as a driveway.
It's a sprawling Mission Revival property, a complex of terracotta-roofed buildings surrounded by a wall that encloses an open courtyard in the center. Oil lanterns made of rough glass and wrought iron are spaced along the porch.
The owner's commitment to authenticity is impressive.
I don't know that he necessarily went in, she says. And he wasn't supposed to. I'm more concerned that he never called in, and he's not the sort to do that. And his truck is still here.
And that was when?
Couple days ago, she says.
I met Gabriella at the motel and followed her up to this middle-of-nowhere property. We've parked our cars well away from the house, neither of us trusting whatever the hell this is.
I don't care about my car. I stole it a couple hours ago. But Gabriella owns a dark purple charger that she'd rather not have damaged or destroyed should whatever this is turn out to be dangerous. Having had a sweet Cadillac Eldorado blown up into scrap metal under me, I can understand. Of course, if it's dangerous to the cars, then it's dangerous to us. Neither one of us really worry about that sort of thing, though.
I go up and touch the wall, check the rough-hewn double door and its hammered iron handle. There's no lock. Everything looks new, or newish, at least, but the design is old Rancho California. I work my finger into a crack on a wall and pull out a chunk of mud plaster, showing dried mud and straw underneath.
This is real adobe, I say. Who the hell builds with adobe anymore? There are no power lines I can see. Windows are shuttered. At one end of the courtyard, there's what looks to be a chapel, the cross on the roof cracked and weather-beaten. How'd you hear about this thing?
The internet, she says. If you can filter through all the NIMBY whining, it's amazing what you can find out on next door. Couple people ran across it about 3 months ago on a hike. Next weekend, it was gone.
And now it's back. I have no idea what next door is, but knowing people in the internet, I can guess.
And now he's back, she says. Seems to come and go. I had him set up a few trail cams nearby. Streams video. 1 second he's there, the next he's not. Few hours later, he's back.
Pattern, I say. If it's coming and going at regular intervals, then... still doesn't tell me what the fuck it is.
Not that I've noticed, she says. And we've got good coverage. He was Army Special Forces. Used to do shit like this all the time.
Special Forces? I didn't know you had somebody like that on the payroll.
You've been busy.
Busy, in this case, being a euphemism for dead. You catch him on video?
Yeah. He walked into the frame when the house appeared, and then... walked out. Doesn't look like he went inside. At least, not through the front door.
You trust him?
More or less, she says. I know he's not going to try something like simply skipping town. And if he'd stolen something from me, I'd have known. He came here and something happened. But I have no idea what.
I'd write this whole thing off as a loss, I say. Seal this place up with wards so nobody can go inside. But you won't do that, will you?
You wouldn't either, she says. Much as you'd like to pretend you would. I don't throw my people under the bus. Also, this house shouldn't even be here.
How so?
It's not on any modern planning maps, never been zoned. This should all be scrub brush and coyotes.
You said modern planning maps?
You found something. How far back did you have to go?
Old Rancho days. Place was owned by one Jose Miguel Garcia, who was granted the title in 1786. It was ceded in the 1850s to the territorial governor when the U.S. took California. At that point, nobody owned it, and as far as I can tell, the whole place was gone by then.
No heirs? Usually, there's at least one person in Southern California who can say, my great-great-so-and-so used to own that for just about every piece of dirt.
There's a story in that, she says. His son, Don Miguel, married Juanita Hernandez in 1814. Had three boys. Found death records for all four of them. Juanita drowned her kids in a pool in the courtyard. Miguel came home to find her crying over the drowned kids. They say she drowned herself and he shot himself in grief.
Something sounds familiar. And then I have it. Wait, this isn't... It can't be. That story doesn't even come from here.
Besides, the husband shooting himself sounds a little like it, doesn't it?
There's an old story, La Llorona, the Weeping Woman. Shifts around depending on where you hear it, but the basics are this. A woman marries some rich asshole, bears him two sons, and then gets thrown over for a younger, prettier version. So, while her husband's off banging his new sweetheart, she snaps and drowns her boys in a river. Too late, she realizes what she's done and tries to save them, but they're lost to the current. She searches and searches the banks, crying the whole time for her lost boys, until she herself keels over from... fuck, I don't know, exposure? Anyway, the rest of the story is that she haunts the place where her children died looking for them, constantly wailing. If you hear her, bad things will supposedly happen to you. Like you'd guess, it's used by mothers to get their children to go to bed, telling them that La Llorona will get them if they don't chill the fuck out. I think I met her, I say. A memory from my time as Mictlantecutli bubbles to the surface.
Excuse me?
Mictlan. The original story's Aztec. The hungry woman. The starving mother. Something like that. It's more complicated. Some of the dead gods were involved. Cihuacuatl, Coatlicue. But the woman herself was just as human as everybody else in Mictlan. There's a long pause, something I've gotten used to when I blurt out shit like that.
How much are you remembering lately, Gabriella says, about being Mictlantecutli?
The stuff that I was directly involved with? Pretty much all of it, I say. Everything else is sketchy unless something triggers it. I can pull off some stuff if I really concentrate. Most times it's like that word that's always on the tip of your tongue. Kind of maddening, actually. When something does trigger them, memories come flooding in. Sometimes a little, sometimes a lot. Like now, thinking about Cihuacuatl and Coatlicue. Two goddesses Mictlantecutli couldn't save 500 years ago when the Spanish took out most of the gods as they were subjugating the people. I shake off the memory. The sense of failure. The anger. The despair. Those aren't mine, no matter how much they feel like they are. And thinking about those memories won't lead to anything good. Anyway, I say, seems a bit of a stretch. Doesn't mean it's not related, but it's almost cliche.
It gets better, she says. One story is that Juanita tried to raise them from the dead, and she drowned herself when he failed.
That's unusual.
I think so, too. But I figure before I do anything else, I should call the expert in dead things to take a look and tell me what he sees.
Fuck all, I say. There are no ghosts in, around, or within a mile of this place.
Is that normal?
Not even close. This is a literal dead zone. There is nothing here. At the very least, I'd expect a couple of wanderers, maybe a haunt or some echoes from a car crash nearby, but this is just a big ball of nothing. One of the perks, if you want to call it that, to being a necromancer, is the ability to see ghosts, those cast-off shells that are left behind from traumatic deaths. There's a barrier between the living and the dead, which is a good thing, because the dead eat life. They're always hungry,
and if they ever cross that barrier, a lot of people end up with their souls devoured. But there's more to it than that. The other side is like a funhouse mirror of the living side. If something's been in a place long enough, it leaves a doppelganger over there. Best example I know is the Ambassador Hotel down on Wilshire where Bobby Kennedy was assassinated in the 60s. It closed down a long time back and was demolished years later, only to have a school built on the old grounds. But, on the other side, the Ambassador is still there. In fact, it's more than just a hotel. It's been so filled with events and life and mystique during its existence that it didn't just become part of the psychic landscape, it gained a sentience of its own, and now it's a ghost itself. Nice place. Good conversationalist. Mass murderer. I used to have a room there until I collapsed it on an 8,000-year-old djinn. If this house has been around for very long, I'd expect to see a dim outline of it through the veil, but I don't see anything. Wait, I say. I crouch down and squint. There is something on the other side.
I'll be right back.
I slide over from the living side to the dead to get a closer look. A burst of jet engine noise, the world going from vibrant color to washed-out grays and blues. Like I thought, the house doesn't exist on this side. But I do see something.
It's not here,
Gabriella says, sliding over next to me. She's already sweating from the effort.
I don't know why you do that, I say.
Most mages can learn just about any spell. Though Gabriella's not a necromancer, she picked up this trick before I ever met her. But, like with most people, the dead side is not kind to her.
Subverting expectations, she says. People underestimate me.
You are good at it, I say. You see that?
Barely, she says, blinking.
Most people, mages included, can only stand to be over here for a little while before the environment leeches the life out of them. I walk over to a series of boulders that probably haven't moved in a few hundred years, so they exist on both sides, taking care to not step into the perimeter of the house itself. A black military boot sticks out from behind the rock.
Found him, I say.
Gabriella walks over.
Fuck! That's Earl.
She bends down to take a closer look at the body. She starts to tilt.
I grab her before she can keel over. Can you get out on your own? I say.
She nods.
I think so.
Then go, I say. I'll bring him out. You don't want to pass out here, trust me.
She nods, wipes sweat from her brow, and disappears. Aside from having decades of prior experience, I got a crash course in death god studies over the last few years. Before I died and went to Mictlan, I'd be feeling entropy sucking at my soul out here. Now, I don't feel a thing. Like, I could be over here for hours. I guess death has its pluses. I look over Earl's body and have more questions than answers. If a living person comes over here and dies, it's usually because ghosts ate their soul. They leave distinct marks on a body, deep, cold gouges that look like freezer-burned chicken. But he doesn't look like he's been attacked by ghosts. That's not as weird, considering there are no ghosts here. Spend too much time over here, and the environment itself will leech you dry. But it doesn't look like this. What he does look is about 100 years too old.
Maybe this is what he looked like before, but I kinda doubt it.
Not going to get many answers over here. I bend down to pick up Earl's body. He weighs next to nothing. I shift his weight, and I hear something crackle. Flakes of skin drift to the ground. As they reach the ground, I see it. I set him down and slide over to the living side to look at the spot where his body lies on the dead side. It's just outside a side door of the house. I slide back.
What is it? Gabriella says.
She's a little ways away, leaning against another boulder. She looks a little green.
He was inside the house, I say.
Then, something happened, he came out here and he died. Or he died and was pushed. I point out the depressions and prints in the dirt. There are boot prints from him, but they only get a step and stop. but a second set of prints, plain soles, small. A woman's or a child's feet. They stop next to Earl's prints. He was killed on the dead side and then pushed over to the living.
I don't see any blood, she says.
It was only a quick look, but I didn't see any wounds on him. How old is he?
Mid-40s, she says. Why?
I slide over, grab his body, and slide back. See for yourself.
What the fuck happened to him?
Old age?
The hell does something like this?
I can think of a few things. I have a pocket watch that, if you spin the crown, point it at something and push the button, makes things age scarily fast. But it's about as precise as a hand grenade. You think Kyle will be upset if I use his morgue a second time?
It's not his morgue, she says. It's mine.
You should tell him that.
Oh, I think I can let the necromancer take all the blame for telling off the volunteer pathologist.
Ouch, I say. You wound me.
That's why you love me, she says.
There's a pause, neither one of us knowing what to say to that. We've had a strange relationship. And over the last few months, it's gotten stranger.
Anyway, yeah, she says. I've got a morgue back at the shelter. State of the art and everything. Cost a fortune.
I am clearly in the wrong line of work, I say.
That's okay, she says. When we go out on dates, I'll pay. I'll be your sugar mama. But I expect you to put out.
Yes, ma'am. There's a pause.
I do not like where this is going, Gabriella says.
What? You don't like the idea of me putting out? I'm offended. Or is it that whoever did this is a necromancer powerful enough to go over to the other side and take someone with them while driving all the ghosts out of the area? I have to take a breath after that one.
Something like that, Ja, she says. Would they be as powerful as you?
Not sure. But honestly, I doubt it.
That's something, at least. I guess, she says.
Yeah, it's something all right, I say. But we have a bigger problem.
Bigger than another necromancer?
Yeah, because only one of them's a necromancer, I say.
Cheat,
she says when she gets it. If the person who moved Earl over is a necromancer, then somebody else moved a house 200 years into the middle of nowhere and aged a man to the point that he looks like a mummy. She lets that soak in for a second.
Don't say it, she says. Do not want...
Me either, I say. But you know that's what it is.
A flare of magic grabs our...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.